Good morning and welcome. As we come together in the presence of Almighty God to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and let us begin our worship with a moment of prayer. Gracious God, on this yearly observation of Worldwide Communion Sunday, we hold in our hearts all your people who are scattered around the world. We know it is your desire that we would be one, even as you and your Son are one. And we pray for the coming together of your people in harmony and in love. And Father, during our service, we ask that you would touch our hearts in such a way that we may know that we have been with you. In Jesus' name, amen. And we have a few announcements this morning. First of all, there will, even though it says we're having a relevant service, don't believe it. Well, Sarah is moving today, so instead there will be a prayer and praise service. So still come, but it won't be for what you were maybe thinking you would be having. And the prayer and praise services are wonderful times to worship and praise the Lord and to pray with one another. So do plan to come as well, but it won't be the relevant service. That's very true. It will be very relevant. There you go. And also, we have begun meeting on Friday afternoons at 3 o'clock for a time together to discussing about learning how to think biblically. I'm going to talk about that a little bit more later on. And we invite you to come. We're working with a ministry called My Faith Votes and learning how to see things from a biblical, current events and issues from a biblical perspective. And then on the 19th of October, we're having our MAC fall workshop here at 9 to 2. And Mary Lou wants to make sure that, would you please register? I'm guilty. We haven't registered either. We kind of think, well, it's here and we can just come, but they need to know because they need to know about lunches. And so please, and do plan to come. The Pilgrim Center for Reconciliation is going to be leading the workshop. They were here a couple of years ago, and it's a wonderful opportunity to learn about bringing peace, peacemaking in fractured spaces. So I would encourage you to attend that. And then on the 12th, our dinner and a movie sounds wonderful, Meatloaf. You can read it, the whole menu, and the movie Ordinary Angels. So put that on your calendar as well. And then on the 13th, on Sunday, we have a congregational meeting, and I'm going to invite Phil up to speak to that.
As posted at the entrances to the building here and is communicated in other ways to the members of the First Congregational Church in Hanson, Massachusetts, pursuant to the provisions of Article 7, Section 5 of the bylaws as amended, a congregational meeting has been called at the request of the Board of Deacons for Sunday, October 13th, 1 week from today, 2024, at 11:05 a.m. That means right following worship, whatever the exact time is, in the sanctuary. Immediately following worship, for the purpose of hearing and voting on recommendations from the Board of Deacons and the Vicinage Council that met here on September 29th, 2024, regarding the ordination of Sarah Marcolino. In the congregational way, it's up to an individual church as an independent body to make decisions regarding ordination of individuals when the circumstances arise. We have those happy circumstances before us now, so we look forward to members spending just a few minutes after worship next Sunday to help us with this important and joyful decision. Thank you.
Thank you, Phil. And then the fall fair is coming up, a lot going on this month, and gift bags, the committee needs help putting together gift baskets. So if you have any items that in particular that might be appropriate, and you could speak to Cindy Johnson about what might be needed, and they will be meeting today, and then for the next 2 weeks to put those baskets together. So if you have anything around the home that you think might be appropriate, make it known or purchase something as well. And then finally, our Operation Christmas Child, and I believe we have a video for that.
Children open their boxes, you can hear the laughter, the cheer.
Jesus said, let the little children come to me. I want the children to know that Jesus Christ is alive and he'll come into each and every heart that invites him.
The mission of Operation Christmas Child is to share the gospel with children around the world.
Because we bring gift to the children, the mothers and the fathers accepted the Lord Jesus Christ.
This box gives us a chance to show them that there is a light, there is a truth.
Millions of children around the world are being impacted by these simple shoebox gifts, so we need to keep packing those boxes and continue to pray for the children around the world as we begin to disciple them. God bless you. Thank you.
I've been trying to figure out how they fit a soccer ball into those boxes. And then I realized, oh, you can buy these little pumps that do that. So that was very helpful. All right. And I just wanted to add one thing. Have any of you seen on our church newsletter that little brain teaser that Tammy sent in? Does anybody? Aha. Uh-huh. How'd you do?
Terrible.
Did you get them all? I'm missing one. I'm not going to tell you what this is about. Go to the church newsletter. Scroll down and see. There's a wonderful brain teaser there, and it's very, very good. And but I've been at it like 3 or 4 times, and I'm still missing one. So, all right. With that in mind, it's time for us to begin our worship. Please stand.
Turn in your bulletins or look at the screens for the call to worship from Daniel. Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belongs wisdom and might.
He changes times and seasons. He rules kings and sets up kings.
He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those with understanding. To you, O God, we give thanks and praise. Blessed be the name of God forever and ever. You may be seated.
Let us now bow before our gracious God in prayer. Glory to you, most high God and Father of us all. What an amazing thing that we can look to you, the creator of everything that exists, and call you Father. What an amazing thing that you desire to be in relationship with us, your created beings. What an amazing thing that you sent your son Jesus to die for us so that we can have not only relationship with you in this world, but life eternal in your presence. And in the face of such knowledge, we can only praise you and thank you. This day, we remember the unity we have with our brothers and sisters in Christ all over the world, and we ask that you would touch our hearts with not only an awareness, but a desire to somehow act upon that unity. We ask that you would give us a heart to reach out to the unfortunate and the downtrodden in concert with others. And we also ask that we might ever keep in mind our persecuted brothers and sisters in lands where they're not free to worship you openly, where in fact they are facing the possibility of death because of their faith in Jesus. Strengthen, uphold, and protect them, Lord. We know that our prayers are vital. Help us to remember to pray. Speak to our hearts and minds that we might know what you would have us do in times such as these. Show us the paths you would have us take. Help us to be present to you in whatever capacity you desire. Lord, we lift to you those among us who are in need of your healing touch. We pray for Steve, struggling with addiction. Penny, who has been diagnosed with breast cancer amid other health issues. With Bob, dealing with stage 4 glioblastoma. With Kevin, dealing with a pulmonary aneurysm, and Lord, he's home now, and we thank you for that. We lift you, Margie, as she prepares to come home to you. And Lord, be with all the family members of these dear ones, giving to them the comfort that only you can give. We pray for Mim's family members in Florida, for Kim Neal and her husband in North Carolina, and with all affected by Hurricane Helene. Oh God, send your angels to help with continuing rescue efforts and in bringing the resources so desperately needed at this time. And Lord, we thank you for answered prayer, for Carol's daughter Christine passing her nurse practitioner's board certificate exam, and that Carol's husband Joe has no blockages in his arteries. We pray that you would be with him and Carol when he undergoes future testing. We pray for our nation, O God. We pray that you would do a work among your people. We ask that you would bring into leadership people who know you and who understand your ways. And we ask for your mercy upon us, for we have strayed far from the path that you laid out for us. Give us the opportunity and the desire to turn back to you in repentance and to receive the forgiveness that will allow us to move forward in a positive way. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem and ask that you would intervene in the volatile and dangerous situation in the Middle East, indeed in all the dangerous situations that are occurring around the world. And Lord, we ask that you'd be with all who are unable to be with us. Keep Peter and Carol safe during their time away, and may they have a blessed visit with their son. We pray all this in Jesus' name. And join together in the prayer he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And I'd just like to quickly say that I neglected to welcome all those who are watching online. We're happy to have you with us this morning and pray that the service will be a blessing to you.
As is our custom here, we have plates at the back, and we have, you can mail it in if you have an offering that you would like to make to the church. There's also a QR code that I can see up here, but you can't. It's up here where you can see it and on your screens at home. But let us dedicate the gifts and the talents and the offerings that we make to God this day. Let us pray. O God, receive the offerings that we give to you, back to you, because you've given us so many gifts. Sometimes they're physical gifts, sometimes they're spiritual gifts, sometimes they're intellectual gifts, sometimes they're friendship gifts, and always it's given in love, your love, which is for everyone and all your creation. So Lord, we dedicate the gifts that we give to you this day, that they might be used by you and by the church and by others to serve your kingdom, that it might come on earth partly through us, in Christ's name and spirit. Amen. And we have a very amazing scripture or song of dedication, which I've never heard before. So stand up and sing with me on a song maybe you know and I don't, but I know Jane does, and she's going to lead us. Scripture reading for today comes from the very first book in the Bible, Genesis 1, 26 to 28. And it's the same scripture in every translation. It's just a different way of looking at it sometimes. And sometimes the words are much more current than other times. I'm reading to you from the pew in your Bible, the New International Version of the Holy Bible. Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 28. Then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, over all the creatures that move along the ground." So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Verse 28, God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, and over every living creature that moves upon the ground." So endeth this reading from his word. Thank you.
The story goes that a young couple moved into a new neighborhood. The next morning, while they were eating breakfast, the young woman watched her neighbor hanging her wash outside. "That laundry's not very clean," she said. "She doesn't know how to wash correctly. Perhaps she needs better laundry detergent." Her husband looked on but remained silent. As the days passed, every time her neighbor would hang her wash to dry, the woman was surprised. The young woman would make the same comments. "Her wash is not very clean." Then about a month later, the woman was surprised to see a nice clean wash on her neighbor's line, and she said to her husband, "Look, she's finally learned how to wash correctly. I wonder who taught her this." Her husband replied, "I got up early this morning and washed our windows." We all know what it's like to try to read something or even operate our vehicle when the lenses of our glasses are dirty or fogged up. In order for us to be able to see and do things correctly, our lenses need to be clean. They need to be clear. And in much the same way, for us to be able to understand and discern the truth of any matter, we need to develop a clear spiritual lens. Many of us are naturally compassionate people. Many of us have strong opinions. Many of us view life through our pain. We all view life through our personalities, our past experiences, and through perceptions that have been ingrained in us since childhood. Therefore, it can sometimes be hard for us to critically evaluate the social and spiritual issues that are influencing our lives and the lives of our children and our grandchildren. And because of personal persuasions, it can be equally hard for us to talk about these issues with one another. The way I see it, dealing with these issues is not a matter of being right or wrong. There are always convincing arguments on both sides. Rather, it's a matter of discerning God's heart. Unfortunately, many of today's crucial issues have been politicized. It simply boggles my mind that the outcome of the upcoming presidential election will be heavily influenced by the abortion issue. For whatever you may think about this issue, in matters such as this, we should not be focusing on what the political right or the political left has to say about anything. But we should rather be trying to discern what God has to say, what he has to say about anything. God's word has all the answers we need to live lives that are pleasing to him and that contribute to the bringing forth of his kingdom here on earth, even as it is in heaven. We in America pride ourselves on being free. However, in reality, because we are often ignorant of God's word and God's ways, we can actually be enslaved by false ideologies. As a nation, we have become no different from the ancient Israelites who turned from worshiping God to following the false gods of the pagan cultures around them. Therefore, in order for us to be able to live lives that are not only pleasing to God, but are being used by him to bring about his purposes for his creation, to usher in his kingdom, we have to know God's heart. We've seen in our scripture reading from Genesis that we were created by God to steward his creation, to act as his agents on planet Earth. But for us to be able to do that to his satisfaction, for us to live out his creative mandate, we need to know what he wants for his world. We have to know what he is telling us in his word. We need to be developing and living out a biblical worldview. And Scripture even tells us how we can do that. Romans 12:2, the Passion Translation, exhorts us to stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you, but be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. This will empower you to discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, satisfying and perfect in His eyes. Jesus said, "Keep turning away from your sins and come back to God, for heaven's kingdom realm is now accessible." Or in a more familiar translation, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." Even as the Israelites of old, Christians are mandated to reveal to the world who God is. And we can't do that if we don't know and understand His heart. That is why we need to have and to live through a view of the world as discerned from Scripture. And if we don't have a biblical worldview, just what would our worldview be? A couple of years ago, we did a church-wide study on a book entitled Faithfully Different. The book unpacked in great length and depth the implications of having a biblical worldview versus having a secular worldview. I'd like to quote here a couple of their statements. The secular view of God and man boils down to the idea that we're free to be who we want to be and do what we want to do because there's no higher than human authority who's given us specific information about or direction for our lives. The book further states, the Bible says that God exists, that He created all people and things, and that He has expressed His will and purposes in Scripture. He's our ultimate authority. Secularism says there may or may not be a God, but if there is one, He's content to leave us to the authority of ourselves. The Bible says humankind is uniquely valuable, made for a purpose in the image of God, and accountable to God. Secularism says man is one living product of many that happened to develop through the blind, undirected process of evolution, and we answer to no one but ourselves. The Bible says that God is a moral lawgiver with His character being the objective standard of goodness. Secularism says, or at least functions as though right and wrong are determined by popular consensus. The reason the world is in the predicament it has always been in harkens back to the beginning of time, to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, when the serpent tempted them, saying, "You will not surely die if you eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For God knows that if you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." Because Adam and Eve turned from God and believed the serpent, sin entered God's world. And ever since then, mankind has struggled with the temptation to be like God, to ignore God, or to play God. And unfortunately, it's a trait that most of us struggle with at one time or another, in one form or another. That trait is basically known as independence or self-reliance. We'd like to think that we are in charge of our lives. We'd like to think that we know what's best in any given circumstance. We'd like to think that we can do it on our own. And sometimes this human trait of independence can unknowingly lead us into rebellion against God. Now, before we go any further, let us not confuse our ingrained tendency to be independent from God with our desire and need to be independent from any encroaching tyranny that would prevent us from enjoying and living out our relationship with God as we feel led and becoming His vessels of bringing the gospel into all the world as we've been mandated to do. That form of independence called freedom is crucial to God's being able to work in his world. As I found in some Genesis text notes, within the realm of his visible creation, God places a creature capable of acting as his agent in relationship to other creatures to represent God's claim to kingship over his creation and to bring its full potential to realization, to the praise of the Creator's glory. Even though we were told to subdue the earth, we were supposed to do it in conjunction with the will of God and under his guidance. As we approach this issue, this election, there are many issues that are on the ballot that will be resolved in the way that we vote. And there are many ways of looking at each one. First of all, it is important that we realize that our culture has become largely anti-Christian, and deliberately so. We are in a cosmic spiritual battle, and we need to understand that there is a spirit of deception that is running rampant in our nation, indeed, throughout the whole world. There are so many lies circulating on all sides that it is imperative that we do everything we can to discern God's truth of things. As Christians, we are told to follow Jesus. And Jesus had compassion for people. However, as we follow Jesus, our compassion must be bounded by knowledge of the true facts surrounding a situation. For often, our compassion can be unduly influenced by the information we're receiving, no matter the source. And sometimes, our human mind is being given information that overrides biblical truth. Our compassion ends up being emotional rather than spiritually grounded. With this in mind, realizing that I'm taking a great risk here, I'd like to address the abortion issue. It's a third rail, I know. We'd rather not talk about it, I know. But please, hear me out. There are many facets of this issue that we could discuss, but I would like to focus on one this morning, and that is our human autonomy. In his sermon a couple of weeks ago, Pastor Peter talked about the fact that holiness basically equals our yielding the authority of our lives over to God. And this is where the issue of our independence comes in relation to the abortion issue. I have found it very troubling to listen to the strident voices proclaiming that women have a right not to be told what to do with their bodies, and that abortion is a basic human right that is being touted as health care for women. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Now, of course, women have a right to autonomy over their bodies. That goes without saying. But the implications here go far deeper than that, than that particular issue, for we're not talking about one life, but two. There is also a pervasive lie that many have believed, that a baby is not a human being until it has been born, that it's only tissue and cells. Scripture informs us otherwise. Psalm 139 tells us, "For you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb." And in Jeremiah 1 we read, "The word of the Lord came to me saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart." This tells me that a human life is spiritually viable the moment it is created, that God has created it. It has been said that a human life, that when a human sperm comes together with an egg, an eternal soul is created. And I believe that affirmation to be verified by these scriptures. Scientists have also actually observed that a flash of light occurs at the moment of conception when a new life is created in the image and likeness of God. So, if a human life is an act of divine as well as biological creation, who are we to decide whether or not it will be allowed to live? Now, I've always been a very independent person, no surprise to many of you here. And when I was in my 20s and 30s, I would have been on the front line as a pro-choice advocate. Nobody was going to tell me what to do. I was my own boss. But then I met Jesus, and my outlook began to change. One scripture in particular speaks to that outlook. It's found in 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20, where the Apostle Paul says, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price." Now, I realize that this scripture is being addressed to believers. Nevertheless, Jesus died for everyone. God loves everyone and wants to reconcile them all to himself. And whatever he speaks to his people, he desires for everyone. When you deeply consider the implications of that scripture, you have to reconsider anything you may have formerly believed about your right to yourself and your own autonomy. If God's only Son died on the cross to save our souls, to save us from our sins, how can we ever even think of living life our way? How can we insist on our right to ourselves? How can we rely on our own strength and understanding? I particularly like the way the Passion Translation translates this verse. "Have you forgotten that your body is now the sacred temple of the Spirit of holiness who lives in you? You don't belong to yourself any longer. For the gift of God, the Holy Spirit, lives inside your sanctuary. You were God's expensive purchase, paid for with tears of blood. So by all means, then, use your body to bring glory to God." Now, all that being said, the reality is that many women find themselves bearing an unwanted child for whatever reason. For some, it's a matter of financial survival or life-defining choices. For some, it's mere inconvenience. Whatever the case may be, I believe that a huge problem that we're facing in dealing with this issue is that in striving to protect the life of the unborn, often the needs and challenges of the mothers have been ignored. As I said before, we're dealing with two lives. So the issue isn't only about saving the baby's life, crucial as that is. It's about caring for the needs of the mother also. We were created for God. In him we live and move and have our being. The dearly loved scripture, John 3, 16 and 17, tells us in Passion Translation, "For here is the way God loved the world. He gave his only unique Son as a gift. So now everyone who believes in him will never perish, but experience everlasting life." God did not send his Son into the world to judge and condemn the world, but to be its Savior and rescue it. If God loves the world, that is, everyone he has created, born and unborn, if he is about rescuing every part of his creation, what does that mean for us? As God's people, How do we respond to this very difficult issue? I submit that we respond by becoming aware of and supporting ministries around us that are devoted to caring for the mothers who find themselves pregnant and are in desperate need of help. Bethesda House in Pembroke is one such facility. And I found this on the web concerning their program. Pregnant, parenting a baby, leaving a relationship and have nowhere to go, not getting the family support you need, needing a safe home, frightened by an unplanned pregnancy, we're not all ready for those two pink lines. Not all of us have the support we need to help us take care of our babies. That's why Bethesda House is here, to offer a loving home, practical support, and an education/job track to give you and your baby the best chances at a great life. Then there is a national ministry called CareNet that partners with churches to share the gospel of Christ and to come alongside those in need of help and resources, single women and families for an unplanned pregnancy. Abortion is not the answer to an unplanned, unwanted pregnancy. Compassionate options are. Now, that being said, it is also crucial for us to understand that those who have undergone abortions can always go to Jesus for forgiveness, and he will never, never condemn or reject them. And neither should we. We recall his gentle words to the woman caught in adultery, "Go and sin no more." And this is just one of the many issues facing us as we go to the polls this November. I would like to invite you to set aside previous and present beliefs about the different issues that we're facing and to search the scriptures to seek out God's heart on these matters. If you would like some help and direction, I invite you to join us Friday afternoons at 3:00 here in the parish hall as we work with a ministry called My Faith Votes to explore these issues from a biblical perspective. If you're unable to make it at that time, you can also go on their website, sign up, and work through the 6 sessions on your own. They're not that long. The site is myfaithvotes.org, and there is, I hope, a handout in your bulletin that will give you that information. As Christians, it is vital that we discern for ourselves what God's word has to say, to engage with it prayerfully, and then to have the courage to engage with others to proclaim it. How will others know God's truth if it's not proclaimed? And we will only know God's truth if we read his word and interact with that word in prayer. Praying about difficult issues will help us to discern God's heart and give us his perspective. As a nation, we have turned away from God, and we are reaping the consequences. If it is a spiritual battle, and it's one that will only be won by concerted prayer and biblical understanding on behalf of God's people. But we need to pray with an open heart, let go of preconceived ideas, pray with an open heart, for praying with a closed heart means we will be unable to effectively hear what God has to reveal to us. And we must always, always remember, we are not our own. We were bought with a price. Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we repent of all the times when we've attempted to go our own way in life, when we've attempted to figure things out on our own, when we've insisted on having our own way, when we've strayed from your loving care. Please, God, help us to surrender our lives to you and give us the desire to clean our lenses and to strive to know your heart through the reading of your word. We ask that your Holy Spirit would meet us there and illuminate the truths that you would have us know. In Jesus' name, amen. Today is World Communion Sunday, and as we gather at the table of our Lord, we are mindful that we are in the company of millions of others, for the body of Christ is large and it is varied, and it is present throughout the earth. And gathering together at the Lord's table is special because it signifies not only our communion with Him, but our communion with one another. And it helps us remember that we are all sinners in the need of grace. Let us draw near to our Lord with repentance and allow ourselves to receive the forgiveness, the cleansing, and the renewing that His shed blood accomplished for us upon the cross. Let us pray. Gracious God, we've not loved you well, and yet you continue to love us unconditionally. We've not deserved your mercy, and yet you have been merciful. You have shown us how to live, and yet we've not heeded you. We thank you for the sacrifice of your only Son so that we might be at peace with you, and we ask that you would help us to let go of those things in our lives that rob our peace. Place them at the foot of the cross and come to you for the true peace that only you can give. And God, we thank you for your Son's presence with us as we partake of this meal. In Jesus' name, amen. Would the deacons please come forward? Assurance that no matter how far we may wander from the way of life that we are called to lead, we never move beyond the boundaries of God's love. We are loved, we are forgiven, we are blessed. The Lord Jesus, on the same night he was betrayed, took bread and he gave thanks. And we thank you, Father, for the spiritual nourishment that is offered to us at this table. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your willingness to suffer on the cross, even unto death, that your blood might become a covering for our sins, and we might be made one with the Father and with you. And after giving thanks, he broke the bread, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So ministering in his name, we give you the bread.
Thank you. 8, bread of life. In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Ministering to you in his name, we give you the cup. Drink the cup of the new covenant. And now let us join together in our unison prayer of thanksgiving. Heavenly Father,
you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown to us, but known to you. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us, and your love supports
in peace. Never be afraid. God will go with you through each hour of every day. Go now in faith and show you believe, that all the world may see the way in which you live. Go now in peace, and the Lord will be with you and guide you all the way, in peace and love and charity with one another. Amen.